extremely dangerous when they get inside the body. But the problem is that the current radiation risk model that is applied by all governments all over the world doesn't concede this. It bases its analysis on the health effects of Japanese people who were out in the open when the Hiroshima bomb went off. Many of them, of course, were just blown to pieces. But those people who weren't blown to pieces have been studied in what's called the lifespan study. And effectively, the way in which radiation is assessed by the organizations that assess it in all of the countries of the world now is by looking at the numbers of cancers that are that have developed in the lifetime of those people who were exposed to radiation at Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Now, there is a problem with that. Actually, I'm going to talk in two parts. The first part, I'm going to talk about radiation and health generally, because in order to understand Fukushima, we have to know a bit about radiation and health and a bit about radiation and what it is. So to come back to the Hiroshima and Nagasaki situation, the people who've been studied, and the end point in these people is cancer. They are people who were out in the open at the time of the bomb. And the bomb, you can imagine, was like an enormous flash bulb. So there was a big flash of light, except that it wasn't light, it was radiation, it was gamma radiation. And if you like to think about it, all of the cells in their body were bathed in gamma radiation. So the amount of energy transferred to each cell was the same. So if I have a flash gun and I point it at you and I switch on the camera and it goes poof like that, all of the cells of your body get approximately the same amount of light. And in the case of the Hiroshima thing, the same amount of radiation. But this is not the same for internal radiation. And to understand why, we have to know how radiation works. Now, all radiation, whatever its source, ultimately ends up in tissue in the form of tracks of fast electrons. If you can think of them like little bullets that are shot through your body. And they are like little bullets too, because when they hit tissue, when they hit critical bits of tissue, they smash into it and break it up. So they break bonds, and that's why it's called ionizing radiation. So you all know from your chemistry that all elements form molecules, and you get these molecules in the body. Most of the body is water, H2O. And so when these little electron tracks fly through the body, what they do is they break the H2O up into ions. Now, ions are like highly charged, very reactive chemical species, if you can think of them as little sparks, like little hot sparks. And these little hot sparks can cause damage to any part of the body where they occur. But the reason that ionizing radiation is so amazingly dangerous is because it can affect the DNA. It's what's called genotoxic. And the DNA on the chromosomes define what a cell does. So the reason that you're alive and that your body continues to function and that your liver continues to liver and your kidney continues to kidney is because those cells in there are doing a little job. And the job that they're doing is told them by the library of information that they have on the chromosomes. But this library of information can be damaged. It can be damaged in what's called a mutation. A mutation is when the library, when if you like, the letters in the library or the books of the library are burned. And so instead of saying the cat sat on the mat, the gene might say the cat ate the rat. And of course this change in context or this change in information can cause the cell to do something strange. Very often it just kills the cell dies. But on certain occasions the cell can then continue to replicate when it shouldn't replicate, and that's called a tumor, and then that goes out of control and you have cancer and you can die. This is a rather simplistic account of what happens, but it's good enough for our purposes, because what we're concerned to establish is that the target for radiation is the DNA on the chromosome. That's effectively the target. That's what causes the cancer, that's what causes the heart attacks, that's what causes all of the aging diseases that I was talking about earlier. Your DNA becomes smudged, if you like, and so it becomes old. It can go on to cause cancer. Now, if the DNA is the target for radiation, then it must concern us if the dose to the DNA is higher. And in the case of internal radionuclides, so if you inhale some radioactive substances, rather than standing outside and having been bathed in radiation from the outside, if you actually inhale, say, a particle of plutonium or uranium oxide or these many of these particles which come out of nuclear power stations when they're operating normally, If you inhale one of these, it gets lodged in your tissue somewhere, and it can cause very, very high doses to one cell or a few cells in a community of cells, but no damage anywhere else. Now, the way in which radiation is measured, the way in which it is quantified, so when we measure radiation, they'll tell you your dose is so many millisieverts or microsieverts or microgray. Now, these units, sieverts and gray, it's very important to understand, are units of energy per unit mass. I mean, I hope this is not too technical for many of you, but I'm sure some of you will understand this. That they measure radiation in terms of energy per unit mass, energy per gram, energy per kilogram. And the dose of one sievert is effectively 1 joule per kilogram. Now, if I sit in front of a fire, I can warm myself and I can get a joule is nothing at all. I mean, it can barely warm me up, but 1 joule of energy is very little. But I could get one joule, and I weigh so many kilograms, so I divide that joule by the number of kilograms, and that will give me my dose. And this is exactly the same with ionizing radiation. But you must see that there is a difference between sitting in front of the fire and getting, say, 10 joules per kilogram from that fire, or reaching into the fire and getting a hot coal and eating it. Now, if I do that, I get the same number of joules per kilogram, but all those joules are in one place, in my stomach, if it gets that far. And there's no dose in my leg or in my head or in my arms or anything. So I've got the same dose, but I'm dead. And this is essentially the way in which radiation has been misanalyzed by the current radiation risk model. And we have plenty of evidence that this is so. I mean, since the first discovery of childhood leukemia clusters around nuclear power stations, we have seen massive effects of radiation from people living in the areas affected by the Chernobyl accident. And I myself have done work, epidemiological work, in Iraq, where in Fallujah, for example, there was use of a lot of uranium, and we studied the children there and the parents there, and we found massive increases in disease there from what would be construed as really, really small doses. And so once again, we're in an area where the authorities, in this case the military, argue that they can continue to use uranium because the dose is very low. But of course, the dose from the particles of uranium that get inside you are very high to the tissue that they are close to. So we found, for instance, in Fallujah, we found a 37-fold increase in leukemia in the age group 0 to 34. We found huge increases in breast cancer in women. We found increases in childhood cancer. We found increases in congenital anomaly and so on. And most recently, and we've got a paper now that's in the will be published soon, in which we measured uranium in the hair of the parents of children with congenital anomalies. So that's another example. Then we've looked at infant leukemia after Chernobyl in those children who were in the womb at the time of the Chernobyl accident. In five different countries in Europe, five different research groups have looked at children who were in the womb only at the time of the Chernobyl accident. So this is in Scotland, in Wales, in Germany, in Greece, in Belarus, and in Hungary, and in the United States too. And in all of these children, you find a sharp increase in infant leukemia only in that cohort, in that group who were in the womb at the time of the Chernobyl accident. And there's absolutely, therefore, no explanation for this apart from the fact that it was the radiation. So what I'm saying is that there's massive, massive, massive proof that the current radiation risk model, the one that's being applied to underpin the development of nuclear, the building of a new EDF power station at Hinkley Point and power stations all over this country, this risk model is in error, it's incorrect by a factor of between 500 and 1,000 fold. It's an enormous factor. Unbelievable that scientists should have got this wrong. And so the question is, have they got it wrong? Am I just a madman, a lone voice in the wilderness? What's going on? Well, in 1997, the Green Party asked the organization who have produced the current risk model, an organization called the International Commission on Radiological Protection. They asked them to come to Brussels to discuss the European Directive on Recycling Nuclear Waste into Consumer Goods. You may not know about this, but there is such a thing. It's called the Directive 9629, And it allows the nuclear industry to take its nuclear waste and turn it into pots and pans and saucepans and spectacles and cars and anything you like. Not jewellery and not children's toys, you'd be glad to know. However, apart from that, they are allowed to more or less stick it anywhere. And so the Greens in the European Parliament asked me and a number of other people to come and talk about this, and they also invited this guy from ICRP. And at that time he said, well, because he got a lot of stick, as you could imagine, his name was Jack Valentin, and at the end of it he didn't quite burst into tears, but he said, look, you don't have to listen to the ICRP, you can have your own committee, you can listen to any committee you like. So at that time we thought, okay, we'll set up a committee. So we set up a committee called the European Committee on Radiation Risk. And this is in line with my general strategy in the Green Movement of not fighting with them, you know. There's no point in fighting with them. What we do is we set up our own alternative institutions. So rather than saying, hey, you're wrong, we just totally ignore them. And we say, no, this is the European Committee on Radiation Risk, and we have our own risk model, and we don't really care what you say, because you're a bunch of idiots, and we're not even going to talk to you. And this is fantastically powerful, because as soon as this was set up, and it was set up as a bit of a scam, I have to tell you, we were inundated with requests from independent scientists to come and join us. And we now have over 40 scientists from all over the world in the European Committee on Radiation Risk. Very, very senior, eminent people. One of our members is the head of radiation protection for the Russian Academy of Sciences. And we produced a report in 2003 in which we organized a way in which we could assess the effects of this radiation, this internal radiation. And shortly after that, about 1 year, this report ECRR 2003 was printed, and it was published in Japanese and in French and in Spanish and so on. It was fantastically successful. But a year after it, there was a big study done in Sweden of the health effects of the Chernobyl accident in Sweden. Very, very important study by a young man called Martin Tondell. And what he showed was that there was a significant statistical association between contamination on the ground and cancer in Sweden after Chernobyl. And he actually put a number on this, and the number came out to the one we predicted, which was about 600 times. So by 2003, we had a model that we could apply to the situations where these contaminants this kind of contamination had occurred. And one of these places is, of course, the nuclear test veterans, because they were exposed to these things at Maralinga and Christmas Island and so on. And I have since then done, I think, probably 6 or 8 court cases with test veterans, and we won every single one of them. So in front of a neutral judge or in front of a jury, we can win cases using this method. One more thing you need to know is that the ICRP guy, Jack Valentin, that we met in the European Parliament, he met with me in Sweden, in Stockholm, I think in 2009, was it, or 10? 2009, yeah. Because Ditta was there with a camera and she videoed this, and it's on the internet. And it was a sort of face-to-face. We kind of tricked him into, We tricked him into a confrontation situation. But in that situation, he admitted that his own risk model, the one that he was the author of, and they produced another one in 2007, was wrong, and it could be out for internal radionuclides by a factor of 900 times. So we've kind of come full circle. We have actually destroyed the ICRP risk model. We have destroyed, through science and through reasoning and through epidemiology and other people's epidemiology, we have deconstructed, dismantled the current risk model which underpins the whole of nuclear. Now what this means in reality is that we are all being poisoned. It means that the substances coming out of these nuclear power stations, not just when they explode, not just Chernobyl or Three Mile Island or Fukushima, which we will come to now, but under normal running conditions are going to kill people who live nearby, and slowly by polluting the environment are going to increase the illness in everyone, and there's a whole range of illnesses involved here. In fact, the atomic testing in the 60s, which was the largest injection of radioactivity into the environment that has ever occurred, and maybe up until Fukushima actually, but we don't know yet. This this amount of radioactivity into the global environment actually caused the current cancer epidemic.